أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. We always praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, his companions. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to continue to bless us, to continue to grant us every form of health, to spare our lives until we witness the blessed month of Ramadan. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make the coming month of Ramadan be the best for us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to spare our lives, that we witness the month of Ramadan that is fast approaching around the corner, inshallah, in a few days' time, or a week and some days. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to spare our lives. My beloved brothers, sisters, Muslims, in humanity, in Islam, we need to become closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to become closer to our Maker. We need to become closer to the one who made us. We need to become very, very close to the only creator, the only deity who can solve all the problems we have. We call him Rabbun, the Lord. He created, he provides, he nourishes, he cherishes, he sustains, he protects, he cures, and he is the only deity, Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal, that has the absolute control. He is the supreme deity, he controls everything. So we need to become closer to this one and only deity, and that is the only time we would enjoy our worship, number one, enjoy our stay in this world, and that is the only way we would enjoy preparing for the hereafter, and that is the only way we would enjoy engaging in deeds that would make us be heading towards paradise. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us paradise.
وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ.
I have not created, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, mankind, neither mankind nor jinnkind has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created except so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being worshipped. So we try our best to worship Allah alone. We don't want to engage in anything that has to do with shirk. We take seriously the tawheed, the belief in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We take seriously the belief in the oneness in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't want to engage in shirk. We don't worship a stone. We don't worship a stick. We don't worship the masjid or the Kaaba like people think. We don't worship a book. We worship the one and only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one who created us. He is the only one we worship, and we love him, and we want to become close to him, and we love his Rasul, his Nabi, Afdalul Khalqi wa Akramul Rusuli, the best of the entire creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right from the beginning of time up to the end of time, and the best of all the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the beginning up to the end of time. It is written, it is slated, it is closed, and it is permanent. Nobody can be better in terms of human than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammadun sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad ibn Abdullah al-Hashimi al-Qurashi sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa ashabi ajma'in. We praise him upon all conditions. And we also love the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is why anytime we hear someone say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are so happy. Anytime we hear someone say Muhammad, we say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we become sad when someone hears Muhammad and he doesn't say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Aren't you proud? Aren't you happy that you are from among the ummah of this blessed messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Man salla alayya, man salla alayya wahidatan sallallahu alayhi biha ashra. Whoever sends blessings, salutations upon this messenger we are talking about, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Maker himself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses them 10 times in return, it is a bonus because of the status of this messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we want to become closer to Allah. We want to become closer to the Maker himself. And now when we talk about closeness to Allah, there are so many things we can do or we are doing and we need to continue doing, or there are things that maybe we don't do and we need to start doing them, and they are nothing, or there are things that are not very difficult. Things that are not very difficult. You can be a normal Muslim, a normal human being, you do your normal act of worship and you become very, very close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And wallahi, there is no way. When you are close to Allah, you feel the closeness. You definitely would feel the closeness. We're not saying you have to look at people and tell them, I am pious, I have the beard, I pray 5 salah a day, 6 I do tahajjud, I am close to Allah. Wallahi, you don't need to tell anyone. When they see you, they see the happiness in your face. Everyone is sad. A calamity befalls, something happens, everyone becomes sad, you are happy. Why? Because you are close to Allah, and Allah has granted you contentment of the heart. Allah has made your heart be at peace, so everyone would begin to love you. Because for indeed, when you begin to worship Allah and you become closer to Allah, Allah begins to love you. Allahu Akbar. And when Allah loves you, it is automatic. The angels will be informed and they would begin to love you. And all other creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would begin to love you. That is why it is very common and natural for someone who is close to Allah, people begin to love them. It is not magic they do, it comes from Allah. It comes from Allah. So we need to start doing things that would make us become close to Allah. There are so many things, we can't talk about them all, but there are the basic ones, and there are the ones that sometimes we ourselves, myself included, sometimes we become so reluctant and we don't take them seriously. We talk about dhikrullah, the remembrance of Allah. We talk about, in fact, dhikrullah and any other thing I want to mention afterwards, we would classify them under dhikrullah. We talk about the remembrance of Allah, dhikrullahi. The remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is something that you look at the word, it is broad and it encompasses so many things. But really, out of everything that has to do with the remembrance of Allah, you need to take one as yours. You want to take seriously. Keep aside, I don't mean you shouldn't do, I mean, of course, number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves more than anything else that which he has made compulsory upon us. What are these things? The 5 daily prayers. We have Salah al-Fajr, Salah al-Zuhr, Salah al-Asr, Salah al-Maghrib, and Salah al-Isha. These are the 5 daily prayers we have. This we have to try our best to fulfill upon all conditions and upon the timing of the Salah. We try our best, we don't become lazy. So this is slated, this is on one side. Then we have so many other things that we need to begin engaging in, and as a result, we would become close to Allah. Now I would want to explain about these 5 daily prayers, because the way I said it now, you may think, okay, I've spoken about, he said 5 daily prayers, let's keep that, it is slated, let's talk about something else. No, now I want to talk about the 5 daily prayers as well, because they are very, very important. Very, very important. Just these 5 daily prayers alone, you take them seriously, you become very close to the Maker. You become very close to Allah. We have spoken so many times how you should take your time in ruku', you take your time in sujood. You increase the number of times you say what you say in ruku', and the number of times of what you say in sujood. These are some of the things, but we want to tell ourselves, basically, these things we are talking about, there is one thing. Number one, we are praying, fulfilling the 5 daily prayers for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then we know Allah has made these five daily prayers compulsory upon us. And then we know the reward we are going to get and the closeness and everything. And all together from the beginning, there is something that is known as the intention that we have for this prayer. Are you praying it for the sake of Allah? From the beginning, it comes first. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. Indeed, every action, actions are judged by their underlying intentions. So these five daily prayers, number one, we have the niyyah, we have the intention, and we pray them for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's a difference, very big difference, between one who prays the salah because he has no other option besides praying the salah. And then one who prays the salah because he wants to pray the salah. One who prays the salah because he wants to pray the salah. And one who prays the salah because he has to pray the salah. When you pray your salah because you have to, then maybe there is a big, big probability that this closeness we are talking about, you may not achieve it. Like one who prays the salah because he wants to. When you have to, I don't care. You rush, you pray in 1 minute. You rush, you don't do it properly. You do the way you want. Is it not Salah Zuhr? I've prayed it. Is it not Asr? I've prayed it. Is it not Maghrib? I've prayed it. Is it not Isha? I have prayed it. No, it is not about you have prayed it. Did you pray it well? That is a question. So when you pray Salah because you want to, you pray it well. You pray that Salah well. Imagine not just Salah, anything you want something, you do it properly. You do it properly. You do it properly. Your own thing, you do it properly. When it comes to someone else, you may not do it well. You know, I just want to help him, maybe let me just do it. But if it is yours, you would take your time. But at the same time, there are people who, when it is someone else's thing, they do it well. Ask them why. Because they love that person, they respect that person, and that is why they are doing it well. Well, the example of Allah is higher. Don't you love Allah? Then if you love Allah, you should do it well. So many people have girlfriends, perhaps haram relationship. They want to do everything. They do it well. They take their time. They type the long text message, and I love you, and I really love you, and they say everything, and it's all a lie. And then if she falls prey to it, her life gets ruined sometimes, because they're going to be in this relationship for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. Dad doesn't know, mom doesn't know, relationship has been growing, all the I love yous and all the picnics and the restaurant visiting and the park visiting and everything has been done, and the parents don't know, and the children only meet the parents when they want to halalize the marriage, because the parents are the only ones that can halalize the marriage. Not this type of I love yous, the real one, the real one. The real one, you love someone, you do their things properly. Your mom, your dad, you are happy when your mom sends you. You know, I was talking to Brother Sadiq here, and he told me at home sometimes I don't like going for errands and doing things of such. But when it comes to my mom, I take my time. Whenever she sends me, I'm the happiest person. I do it properly, I spend my time. What is this? Out of love, because you love the mom and you know the status. Well, their example of Allah is higher. You love Allah, you take your time in salah. You take your time in salah, and then definitely you would achieve the happiness. You would achieve the happiness. You would achieve the happiness. So this is one thing. Take seriously your five daily prayers, and every time you just make sure you are calm, make sure you don't disturb yourself, make sure when you come for the salah you achieve 100 Subhanallah, you can't achieve 100. No one achieves 100. No one achieves 100 concentration in salah, but you try your best to achieve the highest you can achieve. Is there anyone here who, when he comes, Allahu Akbar, from the beginning of the salah to the end, you don't think about anything beside the salah and every other thing that is related to the salah? Anyone here? Not even myself. We can't. It's not possible. You just try your best. You try your best. And Allah would help you. Because
Inna salata tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar.
Indeed, salah would protect you from immorality and then evil when you fulfill your salah. So I've taken my time to explain beautifully about salah. And wallahi, you need to try it. You'd become closer to Allah. Number two, actually the first thing I said is dhikrullah. Then I classified. So many things can come under dhikrullah. Anything you're going to spend your time to do for the sake of Allah, which goes in accordance to what Allah has told you to do and what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has taught, then it is dhikrullahi. Dhikrullahi. Number one, we've spoken about salah. Number two, we want to speak about Quran as well. We spoke about this yesterday. So today we just try to say Quran as well. Take Quran seriously. We brought so many types of ahadith. Al-Quran hujjatul laka aw alayk. Inna Allah yarfa'u bihadha al-kitabi aqwaman wa yadhu bi akharin. And so many other ahadith that talks. They talk about the Quran and the value of the Quran. And wallahi, you become happy when you take the Quran seriously. Recently, a video was doing its rounds on WhatsApp. I don't know if you saw the video of a brother, and then the sheikh was reciting the Quran, and the brother was seated. And then everyone, they were happy listening to the sheikh. He came, he was standing just like I'm standing here, and he was reciting the Quran, and they were reciting with him because they love the recitation so much. He visited the country. I believe the country is Tanzania. He visited the country. So they usually see the recitation online, and imagine when they see him real life and he's just reciting just like the way they see online, and they're so happy he's reciting, they're reciting with him. And then a brother seated, the sheikh was reciting, smiling, shaking his head, smiling, moving his body. And before you know, the brother just did something that was like almost a dance. And it was going, it round. And the sheikh, the brother seated there, I believe he was a sheikh there also. This dance wasn't like deliberate. He didn't even know how. He was just smiling. When the sheikh recited one verse, he got to the end of the verse, he just did something. And it looked just like a dance. And the video is doing it round now on WhatsApp. This is the beauty of the Quran. Today as well, on YouTube, I saw another video. I think this was in Egypt. The sheikh was reciting, and two of them seated beside the sheikh, they were just smiling, shaking their heads. One wanted to even fall asleep, and he was just happy. This is the beauty of the Quran. Wallahi, real happiness. You become close to Allah. It calms you down. It calms you down. I witnessed a case of a marital dispute between a brother, sister, meaning husband and wife. And so there was, I don't want to go into the details of what happened, but they were there and it was a big dispute they had. And the brother, mashallah, he was very calm. He was trying to resolve the dispute, calming her down, but she refused. She kept on shouting. Later on, he got angry. And then when the brother realized he got angry, he just kept quiet, went to the side, sat on the chair, opened his phone, opened the Quran up, he read some Quran, and he doesn't even know how he automatically became calm. All the shouting, He just became calm. He was just too calm. He doesn't even want to talk again because he's in another world entirely. Subhanallah. The Quran, it brings about comfort. It brings about comfort. Subhanallah. That verse talks about those who believe, they achieve contentment of the heart with the remembrance of Allah. The recitation of Quran is part of the remembrance of Allah.
الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَتَطْمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُهُمْ بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبُ.
Indeed, those who believe, what happens to them? They achieve happiness, contentment of the heart. Their heart is hearts always at rest. Why? Because of the remembrance of Allah. Recitation of Quran is one of the biggest remembrance of Allah you can engage in. Imagine the word of Allah. Number one, we said Salah. Now we've spoken about the Quran. Number three, we want to say, as a Muslim, your own character and your own conduct is a remembrance of Allah as well. What do I mean? Remembrance of Allah, what do you mean? When you take yourself, you do yourself well, you act responsibly, it is because, you know, the Prophet taught, don't abuse, don't do this, don't do that. You are doing this for the sake of Allah. You are remembering Allah, fearing Allah by not engaging in what the Prophet said, don't engage in. And then, as a result, you are building your character and your conduct. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked, two things take you to paradise, he said, taqwallahi wa husnul khuluqi, the remembrance of Allah, and then your good character and conduct. Taqwallah an taj'ala baynaka wa bayna adhabillahi wiqaya, to put between yourself and the punishments of Allah a barrier. You are not going to hold a stick and say, no, I want to put a stick here, this is a barrier between me and the punishment of Allah. No. The things you do in terms of dhikrullah are the things that would help you, and they would stand as a barrier between you and the punishment of Allah. Remember, we just said, inna salata tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar. When you engage in al-fahsha and munkar, you would be gaining the wrath of Allah and the punishment of Allah. Now, because you engage in salah, which is also dhikrullahi, it has become a wiqayah between you and the punishment of Allah, and this verse supports it. As-salah tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar. Allahu Akbar. Then husnul khuluqi. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the best from among you are those who are best in terms of their character and conduct. The best from among you. Khiyarikum ahsanakum akhlaqan. The best from among you are those who have the best character and conduct. Now we've spoken about three things. The same Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam again was asked. Now two things, you've told us about two things that would grant us entry into paradise with ease. You said taqwallah and husnul khuluqi. Now tell us two things that would take someone to hellfire. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us. He said, al-famu wal-farju, the mouth and the private parts. What do you say with your mouth? You abuse, you swear, you do every other negative thing with your mouth. Do you guard your private parts from haram, engaging in haram? These two things take someone to hellfire. Al-famu wal-farju.
يوم تشهد عليهم ألسنتهم وأيديهم وأرجلهم بما كانوا يعملون.
The day when their tongues, their hands, and their feet will bear witness against them as to what they used to do. يَوْمَ تَشْهَدُ عَلَيْهِمْ. That day. All these things we've mentioned would bear witness against someone as to what he used to engage in.
كُلِّ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ وَكُلِّ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ وَيَحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنَّ.
The same verse, different verses talking about the same thing. The believing men, lower their gaze, guard their private parts. Believing females, do the same. Lower their gazes and guard their private parts. With this, you would be building yourself and you becoming closer to Allah. And people see you, they just become inspired by your character. Remember, when you want to build your character, you don't care about what people do or what the community do or does. And what they think of a good character and conduct, you don't care about this. You are building yourself because you love Allah and you want to become close to Allah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us. Aqulu qawli hadha wa sallallahu sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad.